So welcome everybody. This is the last of the substantive sessions of a two-day conference on indicators as a technology of global governance, organized by the Institute for International Law and Justice here at NYU Law School. So we've covered quite a range of theoretical perspectives on this question of what an indicator is, how it works as a technology, how it compares to other technologies of governance, forms of exercise of power, what the alternatives to indicators are, whether indicators are substitutes for law, complements to law, how they work in with law in various ways, moves towards regulation of indicators, which are beginning to develop as indicators become more significant, demands for transparency, participation, making of indicators, and in their use, demands for review mechanisms, accountability, giving reasons when indicators are being produced or being used. And we've looked at quite a number of specific subject matter areas where indicators are important, human trafficking, some economic, global economic activity, credit rating agencies, healthcare, provision of vaccines, immunization around the world, quite a range of other specific areas. We turn now in this final session to look at three more quite closely connected areas where indicators either are important, are being produced, are becoming more important, where they're certainly part of the governance, the organization of very important fields of human life, struggle, misery, people hope improvement. And these fields are ideas of state effectiveness and state failure, the assessment of internally displaced persons and other human rights questions, particular focus on Colombia, and the provision of humanitarian emergency relief, reconstruction assistance management with a particular focus on Haiti. So the format is we have three speakers, each covering one of those topics, and then a discussant. I'll just briefly introduce them now. There are bios available also on the website of the ILJ, ilj.org, the indicators section for more details if people want about those or to find some papers and further materials on this topic. We'd also strongly encourage people who have got interested, particularly students, I think, researchers, to look for possible topics in this area. It's become very clear in this 2 days of meetings and presentation here that there are many more fundamental problems about the production use of indicators, their contestation, and specific subject areas or more theoretical problems than there are people working on them. So unlike many other topics, particularly in law schools, this is an area where you can be an innovator, the leader, probably the world expert in your topic quite quickly with a suitable dose of humility. And so we really would urge people to think down that track if you're thinking of areas where it's really important. There are interesting things happening and there's a lot of scope for very useful, either fine-grained detailed work, but also normative analysis, suggestions for how things could be done differently or better. So we hope that this topic of indicators as a technology of global governance is going to be one which takes off. We'll come back at the end of this session to talk about the possibilities of producing an edited book out of this particular conference, but we can see there's much more to do than can possibly be done in the short term, so we urge people to think down those tracks, and it should be very fruitful. And as we mentioned at the beginning of the conference, the ILJ has also given a lot of importance to trying to make sure this is not just a North Atlantic discussion and that there is really substantial participation of people around the world, scholars, think tanks, universities, policy institutes, NGOs, government people in developing countries, addressing issues which are of importance to them, also having an influence in the way in which the global governance is conducted and more broadly changing the contours of the debate. So we have a separate workshop focused a lot on those questions starting this evening, in fact, and then running on tomorrow here at the law school as a part of a project supported by the National Science Foundation. And we're very glad that two of the participants in that project are also presenting their papers here today and will give a flavor of what we hope will be another fruitful source of ideas with a particular focus on development in developing countries. So the three speakers. First is going to be Nehal Bhuta from the New School for Social Research here in New York. He's an Australian, graduated with a master's degree from NYU Law School, and he's worked for Human Rights Watch, was an observer at the trial of Saddam Hussein, and is now a professor with a wide range of interest, transitional justice, social theory, a lot of current issues of global governance, and with a focus at the moment on these issues of state failure and state effectiveness. So he'll be the first speaker. Second is going to be Rene Uruena, who's a professor at the University of Los Andes in Bogota, Colombia, an innovative and important law school there. He's just finished a doctorate in Helsinki University in Finland on participation in global governance, looking at trade, investment, and other regimes. He's worked on access to water issues in Colombia. He's spent a year here at NYU Law School recently before going back to Colombia, where he got involved in the Indicators Project and the wider Global Administrative Law Project. And his paper on internally displaced persons in Colombia and the production of indicators around that issue is one part of his current research. He's also developing this as a field of active work. It's part of a wider global administrative law and international law project involving students and other faculty in Bogota. And our third speaker will be Meg Satterthwaite, who is one of the conveners of our Global Justice Clinic here at NYU Law School, is a clinical professor, has also led the International Human Rights Clinic with colleagues. Rene is with much success and is one of the co-directors of the Center of Human Rights and Global Justice here at the law school. She has a long background of working in Haiti for many years. She's also worked a lot on women's issues. She has been heavily involved in litigation and other clinical activities around involuntary renditions and detention issues in relation to anti-terrorism measures, but she also has this strong separate interest in economic and social rights. So she's been working on a project on access to water and provision of water in Haiti before the tragic earthquake, and has now been heavily involved in post-earthquake struggles and reconstruction. And her paper will pick up some issues on the use of indicators and the management and organization of that. And then the discussant will be Professor Ryan Goodman, who's very well known in the field of human rights, co-author of one of the leading international human rights books, is now working a lot on international humanitarian law, laws of war, which he has a book manuscript in progress, has worked a lot on national human rights commissions. He has a PhD in sociology as well as his law degree, and brings a strong interdisciplinary approach to the study of human rights, which really make a strong contribution there. And it runs a seminar on human rights scholarship, which many of our students are taking, and we welcome particularly that group of students who are coming here to see, cheer at, challenge some human rights type scholarship, which is being done by our three speakers, and no doubt they'll have plenty of chance to challenge Professor Goodman's comments, if not today, at another time. So we start now with pleasure with Nehal Bhuta.
Thank you very much, Benedict, for the introduction, and thank you for the opportunity to present here. My first thing that I wanted to say really is that this is empirical work in quite an early stage. I've begun in earnest really only in the last 3 months, consisting of preliminary interviews and the collection of documents, materials, artifacts, which relate to the emergence of indexes of state failure. And one of the first challenges I faced, which in many ways reverberated through all the forums here today, is really how to think about indicators. Because in many ways, I think what we've seen emerge from this conference are not necessarily a clear starting point, no obvious entry point to the question of how to examine indicators generally, indicators as an technology of global governance, indicators as actors. And I think there's a plurality of possible approaches. I think what I have drawn from the discussions that have gone before me is an interest in thinking about indicators as actors, as Ronan Shamir mentioned. In other words, adopting the aroma of actor network theory and trying to understand how it is that a number acts in the world. How does it produce effects? To my mind, if that's a relevant heuristic, if that's a relevant way of approaching the study of indicators, and I think it is quite fruitful, one implication is a somewhat nominalistic approach, in which we try to tell the story of an indicator. So we provide a great deal of description as to the context of the emergence of the demand for the indicator, the actors who are involved in shaping it, those actors, entities, persons, programs, including computer programs, that produced the indicator, and the afterlife of the indicator. I think this way of telling the indicator, in a sense, of giving a biography of the indicator, is actually quite important. And I think we've seen some tremendous examples of that in the last 2 days, certainly on the last panel, and for example, in the paper given by Matthias Goldman and Anim von Bogdandi. And I think something that emerges out of narrating the story of the indicator is then also the sort of some deep theoretical questions about how exactly it is that the indicator acts. And I think there is, at that point, questions of the network within which it acts starts to become clearer. So I think Ronan Shamir has given us an interesting example of that. And I see the tremendously detailed and rich work done by Terence Halliday as also an example of something quite compatible with this entry point that I am proposing. So for example, Terence Halliday's argument about ecologies I see in many ways as part of the story of the indicator. I mean, of course, there's a separate story, the ecology of the organization, but the way in which the ecology of the organization interacts with the emergence and production, circulation, creation, consecration of a given number cannot be obviously reduced to the ecology of the organization either. So I think there is a certain benefit in being somewhat nominalistic with, as it were, a structural bias, rather than thinking perhaps grandly in terms of structural themes. So from that point of view, if that's a productive and useful way of thinking about an indicator, in a sense, my answer to the question of what exactly indicators do and the lens through which I will be approaching answering this question in studying indicators of state effectiveness is that they do one or more of the following things. They categorize, they assemble, they iterate, they form inputs and they form outputs, they assimilate, they connect, they frame. They are at once information and transformation. They are assemblages, to borrow a term from anthropology, as well as quantities, as well as explanations. In other words, indicators can act in all of these ways. These are modes of action, arguably. So in approaching the question of the emergence of indexes of state failure, I have really tried to orient my research to unearthing the modes of action of the indicator, which also means an attempt to tell the story of the indicator. What categories did it help form? What categories did it rely on in order to produce the number? And in this respect, for example, I thought that Katerina Pastor's paper was immensely helpful in demonstrating the way in which the categories themselves, once they become part of the production of a number, render all sorts of choices invisible. So in that sense, the number itself presupposes a distributed infrastructure of information which is already in effect. So when we're thinking about the question, what do indicators do, or even the question, how do they govern, in my view, we must also be thinking about, in this sort of somewhat nominalistic way, the variety of ways in which the indicator acts. Now, I just want to make one more sort of theoretical observation and maybe turn to the case itself. So one of the ways in which indicators act, which has become somewhat obvious to me in my work on indicators of state effectiveness, is that they act as emanations of information infrastructures. So obviously all information infrastructures communicate, but what makes them interesting and sometimes powerful is how they cut up the world in order to render it communicable. But this process of categorization and classification upon which an indicator often rests, most indicators require data. Most data requires a database. In order to construct a database, you must construct categories and classifications. So this process of categorization and classification upon which an indicator rests is often less visible, sometimes completely invisible, than the visibility of the number itself. So in a sense, if one of the ways of thinking about indicators is a biography of indicators, what we think of as the birth of the indicator, the production of the number, is actually something of its middle age. Because the DNA of the indicator, the combination of materials that produce its capacity to act, in fact is formed much earlier than the number itself. There is a large and complex, depending on the nature of the index itself, process of categorization, classification, cleaning of data. A wonderful example given today in relation to fieldwork on malaria, which creates a set of inputs that then become combined through some form of operation, some other infrastructure, into an output, which is the number. So if the production of the number itself is the moment of middle age of the indicator, if I can sort of strain the metaphor some more, its death and afterlife is the way in which the indicator then travels. And how does it become another input? So we have, in this sort of temporally segregated way, we need to think of indicators as moments in time between outputs and inputs. And that's, I think, what is partially also captured by the notion of an infrastructure of information upon which the indicator leans. So if that's, you know, sensible, plausible, then when we're asking the question about indicators, we're asking actually a much larger set of questions about information that is cognitively unwieldy. And so one way to make sense of this is to tell a story of the indicator, but with these kinds of categories, ideas, classifications in mind. In a way, one of the things that has been particularly interesting about the sort of information infrastructure is the way in which the process of classification creates practical ontologies. And suddenly you classify, you create an object which is an object in the world. In the third season of The X-Files, episode which I think is called Clyde Brookman's Final Repose, there's a serial killer who has been killing psychics. And we see from the you know, moments where we sort of get some insight into the serial killer himself, that the reason he is killing psychics, because he's desperate to understand why he kills. And so he figures that if the psychic really has psychic powers, they'll be able to know that they're about to die. And if they know why they're about to die, they might be able to tell him why he kills. So he goes through the various people who advertise themselves as psychics, and they have seem to have no premonition that they're about to die at his hands, and so he kills them. Until he finally meets Clyde Brookman, who is a nondescript insurance salesman who seems he really can scry the future. And so it's clear from the serial killer's vantage point that Clyde Brookman knows that this man is going to try to kill him. And so he stops and he asks him, "Can you tell me why I do this?" And Clyde Brookman looks at him somewhat wearily and says, "Son, you're a homicidal maniac." And so at that point, the serial killer is delighted and then proceeds to try to kill again. Now, this is an interesting story more for a variety of reasons, but one of them is because of the way in which it captures something about the nature of categories and classifications, which I have previously suggested are an essential part of the information infrastructure that goes into producing an indicator. The story is powerful and funny because it reminds us that a classification is not in and of itself an explanation, but at the same time, the homicidal maniac now has a label that he and others can apply to his behavior. The classification does not provide any psychological depth. It doesn't actually explain anything, but it does tie him into an information infrastructure, into a set of work practices, beliefs, narratives, organizational routines around the idea of a serial killer. Classification has consequences, and as a result, because it's perceived as real, it has real effects. This sort of vignette, which I can't confess to having encyclopedic knowledge of the X-Files. This is a vignette which is told by two scholars, Susan Lee Starr and Jeffrey Bowker, in their wonderful book, Classification and Its Consequences. This vignette is particularly of interest and significance to the specific problem of failed state indexes. So let me try and piece together a little bit of the story of failed state indexes as I've been able to reconstruct them so far. As I said, this is very preliminary, so I'm approaching this with that kind of theoretical framework in mind. I'm not quite sure what conclusions I can draw. But one of the striking features of the failed state indexes is, of course, that one of the things they do is entrench, render more legible, somehow consecrate the category of failed state. But in addition, if you produce an index which ranks levels of state failure from 1 to 100 or from 1 to 25, you also produce a large set of intermediate classifications of states approaching the limit of failure. So you immediately create, as it were, a new practical ontology. A new set of objects inhabit the world, whereas previously we might have spoken of underdeveloped states, states which face conflict, states which are have civil wars. We now instead have another ontology, which potentially envelops all of these symptoms, called fragile or failing states. And so the very classification and the process of ranking creates not just one concept, but a set of intermediate positions. Now, what's striking is that we've had the concept of failed state for some time, obviously since the early 90s, but in the early 90s and in the 90s mostly, the concept of failed state is a prototype definition. It's a historical type. It's applied to specific instances where what we recognize as state authority has disappeared, Somalia, Yugoslavia, etc. It doesn't emerge as a relative type, in other words, something that occupies a position on a point between zero and one, between a successful or healthy state and a failed state, until people start to try to measure it. So one of the interesting dynamics that I've started to see in my research is that the process of measuring is in itself part of the production of the concept. We've had the concept, the measure didn't create the words and put them in that order, but it certainly has, in a certain way, demanded the specification of the concept in order to make it measurable. And as a result, it's also changed the concept and turned it into a relative rather than a historical type. Now, the actual impetus to measure is quite fascinating, and I'm already at 15 minutes. I'm going to go till 20 and then stop. There's two sort of interesting dynamics which seem to have provoked the demand for measurement. One is a demand for classification by multilateral development banks who have, and all of this happens after around 2004, who identify a particular set of countries who they decide should not be subjected to the same degree of performance-based aid allocation evaluation as others. So one way of, or one impetus for creating an indicator is to create or to establish a set of states that are not expected to meet the same levels of institutional performance before they're eligible for aid. So that was the rationale behind the World Bank and foray into the creation of a category called low-income countries under stress, or fragile states, which I think they now call them fragile states. So that's actually an interesting and sort of not obvious historical reason for the emergence of some ranking format. It's actually to give these countries something of a break. And the other major impetus for the emergence of rankings, particularly the USAID ranking, which you see behind you, or behind me in front of you, is quite different. The context of that is essentially an attempt to redefine the nature of stateness in a way which is conducive to the targeting of aid. So one of the conceptual shifts that is affected by the attempt to measure levels of state failure is also a normative thickening of the idea of stateness in order to then extract from it metrics which can be associated with the absence or presence of stateness. So we can see here that that very chain of reasoning it performs a number of effects and also demands a number of kinds of categories of data. Because suddenly all countries in the world must be able to be put on a scale in which all political histories, all possible causes and consequences of violence, discrimination, unhappy, unpleasant institutions, not quite bad weather, but almost, must be rendered equivalent and comparable. Now, there's a deeper story there about where this data set comes from, which I won't have time to get into, but suffice to say, this is an interesting example of how, even to produce the number, you already rely on 15 years of classification and categorization that begins with the Polity 4 data set in 1994. And it's worth remembering, for those of you who may not know this, that the Polity 4 data set, now widely used by political science, began life as the State Failure Task Force data set in 1993, 1994. So, in the 1 minute that I have left, I guess what I would have hoped to have achieved is at least give you a sense of how, in order to unpack a number, or in order to try and follow the idea of a life story of an indicator, a variety of present-oriented and backward-looking excavation is necessary, as well as a sort of theoretical lens, which is looking at the ways in which political units become measurable and classifiable, but also, importantly, the ways in which other forms of expertise become the resource from which that data is generated. So one of the most important ways, if we define stateness as a mix of effectiveness and legitimacy, and we want to measure effectiveness and legitimacy, we then cast around for data, which might be a reasonable proxy for these things, and lo and behold, of course, we stumble upon governance matters indicators, which become one of the central means through which the data is derived. So you can see, on the concept of sort of practical ontologies, a variety of different ontologies of the concept of good governance, effective administration, are aggregated into a total concept of state effectiveness. Now, this was not planned by Danny Kaufman or any of those people, but what's striking, and this is particularly striking about these kinds of global indicators, is that what we have are aggregations of aggregations of aggregations. So if one of the dimensions of indicators and their power is what they render invisible, then what is rendered invisible by three or four levels of aggregation is quite striking. Now, I've run out of time, but I would like to show you a couple of other pictures, if that's okay, and I won't narrate them too much. But just to give you a sense of the aesthetics, a couple of people have mentioned the aesthetics of indicators. The aesthetics of these indicators are pretty wild. So you've already seen this one, no prizes for guessing that red is not a good thing. Blue is a good thing. So if you're red, it's bad, it's hot, it's uncomfortable, weather's probably bad too. This is the other one of the other major forms of index. Just as an aside, the USAID index is not public. The United States government produces it for its own purposes. It's not designed to have an effect on anyone in terms of discipline. It's designed to orient United States government policy in terms of risk and fragility. So it's an internal programming measure. The failed states index, which has a very different methodology, is a public document produced by the non-government organization, the US Fund for Peace. I can talk about its methodology much more. It's very different. This is the World Bank's ranking, which you can see is actually also very different and reflects the banding nature of that enterprise. The World Bank doesn't really care whether you're 1 or 25. All they want to know is whether you fit within the category of low-income country under stress, which means you will be eligible for certain kinds of additional assistance. This is another state fragility index. In my research, I've counted 12 so far. There could be more that I'm not aware of. I haven't yet examined the methodology of all of them. I've looked most seriously at USFFP and USAID. But again, some comparative, red is not good, yellow is better. Just as an interesting data point, when you start to line these different fragility indexes together, you get almost no equivalence in terms of ranking. Interestingly, you do get equivalence at the extreme limits. So pretty much everyone can agree that Sudan and Somalia are failed states. Obviously, you didn't really need an index to tell you that. But what's striking and what that confirms is that the definition itself is prototypical. We start with an extreme case and define backwards. So that's an interesting also method of classification, which is establishing, contributing to the establishment of a new practical ontology. Maps, people have previously mentioned regions. Ronan, I hope this is extraordinary regionalization. We have blue and red parts of the world. I guess maybe for those of us who have American sensibilities, blue states are good states, red states are bad states. Yellow states, who knows. Similarly, ranking and zones of the world go together in these depictions. These are the breakdown components of some of these indexes. I'm just going to give you a sense of that because I'm already 3 minutes over time. Lots of interesting questions arise about what you're measuring and how you measure it. How you measure a legacy of vengeance seeking, I'm not sure. This is the USAID measures, and this is a great example of aggregation of aggregations. All of these breakout items are actually other aggregations. So, for example, percentage of population experiencing political discrimination is taken from the Minorities at Risk report, which is an aggregation of aggregations too. Finally, what lessons do you draw from these ways of defining stateness? Well, one of the things you define, if stateness and its measurement are defined by legitimacy and effectiveness, presumably that means that governance matters an awful lot as to whether or not you're a fragile state. So as Paul Collier tells us, bad guys matter. Thanks.
Good, thanks, Rene from Los Angeles University in Bogota.
I just need to perform some technical wizardry here.
So anyways, well, Nehal takes care of the technical part. So my idea, or what I want to do is, what I thought that I could do was advance a bit on the conceptual framework that is presented in the framing paper, Benedict Sally's and Kevin's paper, on indicators. So basically, while I agree with most of the insights included in the paper, the point that I want to make here is that this paper, or basically most of the discussions that we have been having here until now, focus on the producing side of the indicator. So basically, okay, give me a second. So basically the idea is, all right. So basically the idea is that while we have certainly observed a lot of issues concerning how are indicators produced, by whom, where are they produced, what problems did they pose to democracy, to transparency, whether they empower expertise or not, there is another end of the indicator, which is the receiving end. We have perhaps touched a bit on this issue when we have been speaking about what are the effects of the indicator. So what do we do with the indicator? What happens once the indicator is out there in the world? So what I figured is it would be interesting to actually do a case study on one of those indicators. Specifically, what I figure is that it seemed interesting to me that the receiving end of the indicator only became relevant or was only, or the agency of the receiving side of the indicator was only recognized when there was this opportunity of gaming the indicator. So this expression, I actually have never heard it before in my life. So gaming the indicator, like, to, you know, when you want to trick. And so it is only at that moment when the receiving end of the indicator becomes relevant. So what I wanted to present here, and the basic point here, is basically that essentially, indicators are not only a top-down process, but rather there's a process whereby the indicator enters the domestic debate, and once the indicator enters the domestic debate, it is creatively appropriated by domestic stakeholders in order to achieve their own goals, in order to implement their own agendas. So, and this in turn, this use, this domestic use, in turn seems to be able or potentially capable of influencing their global use. So what there seems to be this process, this dialectic process of feeding indicators to the global level, back to the domestic level, and from the domestic level up to the global level. So that's in this process, the indicators change, and also they seem to affect other ways of exercising power. So in order to analyze that process, what I did was I looked at the IDP situation. So IDP is internally displaced population in Colombia, and indicators regarding IDP population in Colombia. So for IDPs are different from refugees, I guess most of you know that. So IDPs are people who are forcibly displaced, but within the borders of a single state. So in that sense, they're different from refugees because who have to cross the borders. It is different because the institutions that are concerned with each group of the population, of displaced population, are a little bit different. So in any case, just as many of the issues that we have debated here, the key moment in my story is also the late 1990s. So in the late 1990s, two things happen at the same time with IDPs. On one hand, you have the the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, and the commissioner has been involved in some IDP situations. However, the commissioner, so the office of the commissioner, doesn't have clear mandate to do that, and especially has not been very predictable in its intervention. So sometimes it intervened, sometimes it didn't intervene, and there was this whole move towards asking the commissioner, so please develop some kind of methodology in order for your actions to be more predictable. So you have on that side a crisis, as you may look at it, of legitimacy of the commissioner's actions regarding IDPs. Not regarding refugees, for refugees they have always had competence, they have always had mandate, so regarding IDPs. At the same time, so that's the global scenario that we're looking at the end of the 1990s. At the same time, though, in Colombia, you have the biggest IDP crisis in the history of the country. This situation is specifically interesting because, unlike several IDP situations in the world, in Colombia, people are displaced because of what they call retail violence. So it is not a big act of violence that creates a massive displacement, but rather it is several individual acts of violence against a family member or against a head of the family that forces either the family or the survivors of the people who are killed, of the individual who is killed, to move to the city. So this happens very often in the late 1990s. Why is this important in the Colombian case? Because there is a marginal effect of violence. That means that displaced population that started appearing in the cities in the late 1990s were perceived as homeless people. So their situation was not connected to the political crisis in the rural areas. Why is this important to us? Because the problem was invisible, in a way. So we have this issue of invisibility that we have been discussing here that is directly connected to the idea of indicators. So how do you put an issue in the agenda? You put it through indicators. In the case of the IDP situation in Colombia, you had a clear social situation. However, that situation, because it was marginally increasing, so one individual at the time, it was very hard to perceive as a massive humanitarian crisis. It was invisible, and it was perceived as an expression of urban poverty and not of rural violence. So this continues in Colombia in the late 1990s, and at the mid, more or less 2003, this whole situation, especially this snowball situation, ends up in the lap of the Constitutional Court. Through a series of constitutional procedures, the court ends up deciding hundreds of actions and claims presented by internally displaced people, population, saying that their rights have not been guaranteed by the state. They have not been getting enough, that their fundamental rights have not been protected by the state as they are forcibly displaced. The court then takes a very important decision in Colombia, and the court then decides that this situation is what the court called an unconstitutional state of affairs. So the whole IDP situation is unconstitutional, according to the court. What does that mean exactly? So it is a transversal decision, and that this decision then the court calls upon all administrative agencies and Congress to take decisions in order to solve this unconstitutional state of affairs and actually protect IDP's rights. So the decision is notable in several senses. It's notable, of course, in the sheer scope and ambition of the decision. But specifically, and for the purposes of our conference, it is notable because one of the most important points that the court decided was that indicators should be produced about internally displaced population in Colombia. So one of the big problems, I need you to realize that we're talking about a humanitarian crisis of unseen proportions in the country. And one of the things that the Constitutional Court, so the last instance of justice in the country, says is we need to create indicators. So for the court, it was quite important. And why would the court do that? So since the court takes this decision in 2005, a whole new process of indicators creation began in the country. So what I want to do here in basically 5 minutes or so, I'm interested here in analyzing, because fortunately we have this cutting moment or this specific moment in time when we can say this is before the need to indicators and after the need to indicators. So it is like methodologically very useful in order to make the case study of a use of indicators in a given domestic conflict. So the point here, and what I want to do next, I was telling you before, is basically I want to analyze, as the court ordered the production of all these indicators, what were the political dynamics that were unleashed both domestically and globally around the idea or around this newly found need of indicators in Colombia. So basically that's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to analyze this around basically 5 very interesting points that came out of my research with this situation. So the first one is that apparently the first thing that the court does is the court says, all right, we need to create indicators. So we turn to global agencies in order to provide us with those indicators. So of course they turn to the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. And the commissioner says, don't ask me, I don't have indicators on this. So that's the first problem. They need indicators. The global instance doesn't have indicators, but the commissioner says, by the way, if you do develop indicators, do send them over, because we need them for Sudan, we need them for other situations. So what they do is, they started creating the different domestic agencies I'm talking about, for instance, the Ministry of Justice, I'm talking about the Ministry of what they call Social Protection, the Ministry of the Environment, the Vice Ministry of Water. What they do is they started developing indicators in order to fulfill the order of the court. So, and the indicators are an enormous set of different indicators. Most of them we have been discussing here, but I don't want to get into the detail of the indicators themselves, because what I find more interesting is the political debate that emerged from those indicators. So the first point then is, these indicators were created locally because there was no expertise, at least apparently, globally. But the interesting thing, however, is that once these indicators were created or were developed locally, they were fed to the global institutions. So, for instance, the International Monetary on Displacement of the Norwegian Council, also to the commissioner. And then the global agencies actually fed the indicators back to the domestic debates. So basically the idea is you have this indicator, for instance, enjoyment of social rights in the form of, for instance, access to drinking water. That was an indicator developed at the domestic level. Then that indicator was presented, in, or rather included in the High Commissioner reports on IDPs before the General Assembly. And then that report of the commissioner before the General Assembly was taken again back by the Colombian authorities, and it was said that it was a global indicator. So it was the United Nations that were saying that this and this and this situation was happening in Colombia, whereas actually it was the very agencies that were ordered by the court to create that indicator that actually fed the indicator to the global agencies. So that's one interesting aspect of this case, that unlike several of the discussions that we have been having here, where the global institution creates the indicator or is part of a policy, of a global governance policy of international institutions, and is then forced in an imperialist way upon domestic governments. In this case, rather, what you have is a local need, and then what you have is perhaps a international agencies that free ride that expertise that is developed locally. In this process of feeding back indicators or back and forth from the domestic environment to the global environment, a crucial player is the media, so the news media. It's absolutely amazing how important the media is for the importance of indicators in this case. Basically, I think it's the framing paper that says data is not an indicator. So mere data is not an indicator. And I would say an indicator is not really a political happening without media. I mean, you really need media to kind of translate the issue of the indicators. In this case, the media actually was instrumental in two specific senses. The first one, it presented the indicator it presented the indicator as internationally produced. So it gave it a certain authority and aura of expertise. Whereas if they would have said that the indicator was locally produced, then it would have been a suspect. So that's one important issue of the role of the media here. And the second important role of the media here is that it basically was effective in bringing the issue to visibility. So remember that I was telling you before how this marginal effect of violence made the problem of IDPs invisible because they were kind of covered by the issue of general poverty. In a city like Bogota, you have a lot of homeless people, so IDPs were mixed with, in all the statistics and all the indicators, were mixed with urban poverty. So media and the use of media the use of indicators by the media brought visibility to the situation. So that's the overwhelming importance of indicators. What we did in the research, and then you can find it in the paper that is posted in the internet, no? Is what we did a detailed following of media coverage of indicators from 2005 to 2010. And we did it on national newspapers and regional newspapers, basically to see how the situation, how indicators were covered by the press. And specifically, we focused in the 2007 report of the High Commissioner on the situation of IDPs in Colombia. And what we did is we crossed, as the Commissioner was talking about, indicators. And then we crossed the same as the how the same report was presented a couple of months before by the local NGO that had created the indicator. And then the coverage, I mean the media coverage, was completely different. And the authority that was recognized to the indicator when it was produced or when it was presented as produced internationally was completely different. So that's an interesting thing, and you will see, I mean, in the paper, you'll see more or less how this is analyzed there. So that's the second point, the role of the media. The third interesting thing that we found in our paper, or in our research, was the use of indicators as social mobilization and contestation. So basically, this is a bit beyond. So it is clear how indicators are a tool for mobilization. So it is clear how they are used. I mean, we have been discussing here for quite a while how they are useful for putting an issue in the agenda, to bring visibility, to actually force, for instance, a domestic elite to take into consideration a given issue, because you kind of have a thing, you reify a situation, and then you have an instrument in order, for instance, to name and shame and everything that we have been discussing here. What I found actually is something a bit more interesting, and is a step beyond that point. So it is not only that indicators are tools for social mobilization. I found a situation in which indicators are social mobilization in themselves. So the interesting thing here was there is this NGO in Colombia, which is the most important IDP NGO in Colombia. But basically what they do, I mean, is they use indicators, so they create their own indicators in order to position themselves as experts on the IDP situation, and this creation of indicators gave them access to decision-making processes that they would have never had access otherwise if they were perceived as two activists. So basically the idea, is this. CODES, which is the NGO, you'll find the website and everything in the paper that I gave you. Basically, CODES fashions itself as a think tank of expertise. As a think tank that holds certain expertise, and this expertise is numeric expertise. So we know how to create indicators. They don't gather the data, so that's an important part. It's not that they help others to gather data and they go everywhere. What they do is they create the models where other NGOs, the activist NGOs, feed the data to. So this is important, why? Because while indicators for them are useful to fashion themselves as neutral experts, of course, they don't give up their activist agenda. And so activist they are that, for instance, the director of this NGO was actually attacked by three paramilitary groups tried to kill him because of his work with indicators. And I don't know whether Benedict or Sally remember, we had a conference similar like this 6 months ago, and I actually shared the panel with Marco Romero. I mean, and you heard the guy, and I mean, you couldn't be mistaken. I mean, he was an activist speaking. I mean, and it was very, very clear that he wanted the government to change its IDP policy, and he was an activist. However, his way of doing activism was numbers. Was creating indicators. So I was telling you the story. He was attacked. He wasn't killed, though, fortunately. However, as soon as he was attacked, CODES, the NGO, or the press desk of his NGO, actually released a press communique saying, you know, this guy was attacked basically because he has been speaking against the government on indicators numbers. On IDP indicators, on numbers of IDP population. So It really changes the way, and it really changes the language in which contestation takes place. So it really, the thing or the circumstance that I found in this situation or in this case study is really that it's not only that indicators are a tool for activists, but also that indicators are activism in themselves. So that's an important issue there. And the fourth conclusion that I found was basically that the indicator discussion in Colombia was embedded in a larger discussion, rather. So the issue was not only indicators, but it was indicators as a symptom of a larger discussion on good governance. And here, there are two basic issues that are very interesting in the Colombian case. The first one is that the indicators are the expression of a long-lived, 100 years-lived technocratic dream in Colombian administrative law. So the idea is that you shouldn't have so many politicians in administration, or you shouldn't have appointees by politicians, you should have technocrats who actually are, you know, rational, and they are experts, and they know how to administrate, you know, public goods. This, and that's the idea that the court pushed in a way. So the idea of indicators as empowering this technocracy, but they did so willingly in order to disempower Congress. So the relation between Congress and indicators is another very interesting result of this research. When we looked at all the discussions of IDPs that happened in Congress, they didn't include one single reference to indicators from 1997 to 2008, in 11 years. Not one single reference to indicators. Why? And I asked some congressmen about that, and they would tell me, we don't need indicators to tell us what reality is. We know what reality is because we come from the regions where IDPs, where people are being displaced. So their power was not based on indicators, Congress. Whereas what the court intended to do was actually disempower Congress and transfer this power to technocracies normally based in the executive branch of government. To do that, indicators became a very valuable vehicle, because then the expertise to create and interpret indicators was based in the executive branch and clearly not in the legislative branch. And so the point there being that, you know, in this context, clearly indicators seem useful for those with less political power. So if you have a lot of political power, at least in the Colombian case, you really didn't want to speak through indicators. Your language was a completely different language. And finally, the final conclusion that we found interesting was the idea of indicators as substitutes of binding legal instruments. The court technically doesn't have the power, or actually the jurisdiction, to do a lot of the stuff that is needed in order to change the situation of IDPs in Colombia. However, in order to achieve that result, the court was very well aware that it couldn't take binding decisions, so binding orders, which would escape its area of jurisdiction. So it did use indicators in the sense that it had the jurisdiction to seek information. So, and actually what the court did is, then it said, we need evidence, we need information, we need you to provide us that information through indicators. By doing that, actually the court managed to force certain executive agencies to take a certain course of action without having the actual power to order them to do that. So in a similar way as we find soft power in international institutions, in this case, indicators were very useful, at least for the court, as a substitute for binding legal instruments. There's a lot of details of the case study in itself, a lot of interesting turns of the story, but I don't have enough time, so I encourage you to look at the paper.
Thanks very much, Rene Uruena, and then we turn now to Professor Meg Satterthwaite of NYU Law School.
Thanks very much, and I also want to thank the organizers for inviting me to be part of this conference. And I've been extremely interested by the discussions over the last day and a half, and I feel like I have a difficult task, which is to try to summarize my paper, which is, I think, way too long in a short period, and I feel like it also has relation to many of the things that have been said, so forgive me if I do it rather imperfectly. The paper is looking at the two sets of indicators that are used by professional humanitarians. These are the SPHERE Project Standards in Disaster Response and the Humanitarian Accountability Partnership's Humanitarian Accountability Standard. And these are standards and indicators that were created by humanitarian organizations, so those who carry out direct assistance in the field, who provide water, who provide food, shelter, et cetera, in an attempt to improve the quality, effectiveness, and accountability of their own response to disaster while complying with human rights standards. And that's kind of the story that they tell about the creation of these standards. And the way that I analyze these is builds a lot on the paper that I wrote with Anjanette Roska on human rights indicators. And so I just wanted to say that so that I give her credit, and also hopefully she will be nice to me in the Q&A period. In the interest of time, though, I'm really going to focus on the SPHERE indicators. I really take a look at both SPHERE and HAP, but trying to talk about both of them now would be impossible. So I'm going to cut out my discussion of HAP, and I'm also going to give short shrift to the historical development of the two sets of indicators, even though I think they're really, really interesting and also important for all the reasons that we've all talked about, genealogies being important. The paper draws on a couple of different methodologies, critical analysis, and also empirical research, where I did a set of interviews, on-site visits to Haiti, and also an online survey of humanitarians who had experience working in Haiti. I won't say too much about the survey for the interest of time. I'm also writing a separate paper on the results of that survey. But very briefly, I think it's relevant to say a significant majority of the respondents reported using indicators in their Haiti-related work. And a striking 85% reported that they use a rights-based approach in Haiti. They use indicators and benchmarks in designing, implementing, and evaluating projects, in training staff, in conducting advocacy, and very importantly, in reporting to funders. When asked about the impact of using indicators and benchmarks, these humanitarians overwhelmingly reported they believe the following: that indicators improve accountability to both beneficiaries and donors. They ensure alignment with human rights standards. They enhance inclusion and participation of beneficiaries. They improve transparency to stakeholders, and they improve both efficiency and impact. And just a footnote, I'm using the term beneficiary because this is the term that humanitarians use. These beliefs, I think, if nothing else, really make these humanitarian indicators the object of study, an important object of study. So briefly, very, very briefly, what led to the development of these standards and indicators? As I said, this is going to be really short. Essentially, the humanitarian failures that we're all familiar with. So the killing of U.S. soldiers in Somalia that led to kind of the really shrinking of the UN peacekeeping forces in Rwanda as the genocide began, and also, of course, the failure of the international community to prevent genocidal mass murder of Bosnian men in Srebrenica and other examples. In each of these instances, of course, Western governments turned to humanitarian agencies to provide food, water, to provide basic kind of sustenance at the same time that they were failing to take other bolder steps to halt those atrocities. And humanitarian NGOs, as a result, found themselves in the midst of really a moral dilemma. That's how they framed it for themselves. They questioned their own provision of assistance and their means of provision of assistance to survivors of the genocide in Rwanda, including, of course, most concerningly, armed genocidaire in the camps. And they also questioned their own engagement in the safe areas in Bosnia. Just as a couple examples. So one of the responses to this moral ambiguity was to codify standards that would guide their action and hopefully use, and they turned to indicators as a tool of measuring whether they were living up to those standards. And really the most important project here is the SPHERE project. And it was run by a coalition of NGOs largely based in the global north. And the idea was, as I said, to see how much their services were imbued with quality, accountability, and human rights. And in terms of human rights, just a note on that, they really tried to talk of beneficiaries as rights holders, So they tried to shift the language of charity and say, you know, people who are receiving aid are actually the entitled to certain rights that we're we are providing goods that have to do with those rights, and that we ourselves as humanitarians are duty bearers in some sense. And there's a lot of stuff to say about how that relates to human rights law. And as you can see, it doesn't map very clearly onto human rights law. But they really use this language of human rights as something that was crucially important in developing the standards and indicators. So the standards are organized by sector, water supply and sanitation, nutrition, food aid, shelter and site planning, health services. And then compliance with each of the standards is measured by indicators that are specified. So just as an example to make it very concrete, water supply standard 1, which is on access and water quality, specifies that average use of water for cooking, drinking, and personal hygiene is at least 15 liters per person per day. So it's very, very concrete and very specific. SPHERE in general uses a mix of quantitative and qualitative indicators, but interestingly, when a lot of my interviews would focus on the quantitative indicators, they tended to produce a lot of discussion and both discord and also just sort of a lot of theorizing. So this form of accountability to industry standards rather than to specific institutions or stakeholders is one of the hallmarks of this SPHERE project. Since its launch in 2000, the standards and indicators have been very, very widely used by major humanitarian NGOs across the globe, and they've also been used by some governments in direct humanitarian aid, and there's a lot of discussion there among humanitarians about, for example, militaries taking on SPHERE and using them to measure their humanitarian assistance. Donors also seek information from NGOs about whether they comply with SPHERE sometimes, and they also have been fully revised once, and they're now a second revision is coming to closure now. So I look at these standards and indicators as part of a dynamic in which professional humanitarian actors are deployed to govern the putatively ungoverned, including failed states, states where governments have collapsed, have become predatory, or can't be counted on to provide protection. And at a material level, in many emergency settings, these major NGOs really are providing basic sustenance for disaster-affected populations. So they provide or facilitate access to food, water, what they call non-food items, NFIs, which would be like a tent or a tarp. They also command enormous resources, in many cases much more than government ministries whose tasks they're taking on. And just to give one example, in 2007, the French NGO Médecins Sans Frontières spent more on humanitarian programming than any single Western donor except for the U.S. and the European Union. So it's a really enormous amount of money we're talking about. NGOs are also engaged in more obvious governance efforts, so they set up camp management structures that are charged with ensuring fair access to goods and services. They consult with camp committees, they conduct census, they ensure vulnerable members of communities have priority access to services. And of course, it bears remembering that emergency actions can last many years and even decades, so we're talking about long periods of time. Governmentality analysis, I think, is very helpful in this context. One of the forms of dispersed rule that governmentality scholars have identified is the phenomenon of governing at a distance, which has already been mentioned, through agents of governance that impact the activities of others who are spatially distinct. Humanitarians are engaged in governing at a distance in a number of respects. First, and very obviously, I think NGOs govern disaster-affected populations through those subsistence goods and through the creation of these governance structures. Second, northern-based NGO directors and managers govern southern-based NGO line managers. They also subcontract to local NGOs. Those in the field, of course, are involved in day-to-day dynamics of governing disaster-affected populations, while upper management usually sets policies, frameworks, and organizational structures. And finally, donor states govern at a distance through bureaucratic and technical exercises associated with granting funds, planning programs, and conducting monitoring and evaluation. Especially, and I've heard also this mentioned, the forms collectively known as results-based management or logical frameworks, RBM and log frames, for those of us who have had to deal with them. Those are ubiquitous now among NGOs, and they use indicators as a key element. And so I suggest that it's no wonder that that same logic underpinning those rational management tools also are the same logic that underpin the sphere standards and indicators. And understanding sphere as part of a system of governance at a distance also brings into view the way humanitarians employ indicators as an audit practice. Scholars have identified audit cultures in emerging in recent years in diverse settings where a quest for accountability is satisfied through specific forms of assessment. And specifically, audit arises where a relation of accountability is present between auditor and auditee, where auditors are at a distance from the auditees, and where the auditor and auditee fundamentally mistrust each other. And these conditions exist in the humanitarian setting. And in the paper, I talk about the HAP standard as a specific form of auditing, and it actually has a literal auditing in the sense that NGOs can seek certification as having what they call humanitarian quality by submitting themselves to a certification process whereby the standard itself is measured under an audit. Sphere is slightly different. Humanitarian agencies have responded to those competing demands by attempting to create these audit mechanisms that allow them to demonstrate accountability to all of these competing stakeholders or factors, stakeholders simultaneously. So donors, beneficiaries, and then, of course, the giving public or the tax-paying public in the donor states. And those, of course, might seem to be incommensurate stakeholders, but the idea here is to try to sort of enmesh them in something that can be spoken to at once through these standards and indicators. While Sphere aims to improve quality and accountability to beneficiaries, its audience is not beneficiaries themselves. Instead, the standards and indicators are designed to be legible to internal audiences of NGO boards, of management, of staff, external audiences of donors, and of course the professional humanitarian community as a whole. So now I'm going to turn to my case study, which is the use of indicators and benchmarks in post-earthquake Haiti. So in summary, I argue that the evidence collected for the paper suggests that humanitarians are using indicators and benchmarks to monitor projects and ensure the effective measurable results in their programming in Haiti. However, I also suggest that the evidence suggests the use of indicators has a number of unintended consequences, and I'm going to talk about hopefully three of them, depending on time. So that's about half of the ones I talk about in the paper. So professional humanitarians have, I'll just give you the summary ones, and then I'll go into the longer ones. Professional humanitarians routinely do something they call contextualizing indicators. So they essentially take a global indicator. In the case of Sphere, it's called a minimum standard, and the indicators are meant to measure a minimum standard, but they then adjust them downward. So in an effort to deal with the realities of the emergency in Haiti, for example, they adjusted the space requirement. So there's a space requirement for how much literally how much space you need to create in a shelter. They had to adjust that downward, they argued, because there wasn't enough space in Haiti to construct shelter that had that minimum amount of space. And that is intended to, in part also to reduce the tension that could erupt between those directly impacted by the earthquake, so those whose houses may have been destroyed, who are targeted for assistance from humanitarian agencies, and those who are not indirectly impacted, but who simply may have needs as severe and pressing as those of IDPs. And this kind of adjustment tends to soften or even problematize the minimum nature of Sphere standards and indicators, as well as, of course, their putative rights-based nature. And that results in potentially less urgent funding, for example, to sectors like shelter, et cetera. So it has very material impacts as well. Second, there's an unintended consequence whereby humanitarians' efforts to fulfill indicators that require prioritization of the most vulnerable may lead to a great deal of concern with respect to policing where the line between directly impacted and not directly impacted happens. So in Haiti, there have been some media reports of fake victims, essentially, and there were some very kind of inflammatory ones that sort of purported to have gone to a fake camp where people would go during the day and then at night they would go to their house. And it was, you know, the language in these reports were extremely, I don't even know how to describe it, but it was really very disturbing because the idea was that these people were frauds and that they were just going out and trying to get services that they didn't deserve. So that's kind of the extreme in the media, but the humanitarian community does spend a lot of time literally trying to track where people are. They've created something called the displacement tracking matrix, which is an attempt to see from which camp do people move. Are they setting up camps in both in more than one camp? Are they a real victim or a fake victim? Also, although some indicators include attention to issues of sustainability, by highlighting successes and improving outcomes specifically, they also inadvertently downplay the potential damage that humanitarian interventions can have on existing and nascent systems for delivery of key services. And this is something that has had some very helpful media coverage, actually, where there have been some investigative reports into kind of what have the impact of free services been on people who had for pay services already set up in Haiti. You know, for example, doctors have been, you know, put out of business by the provision of free service, et cetera. To go into one in a little bit more depth, looking at the issue of spontaneous settlement and managed and unmanaged camps. After the earthquake, surviving members of poor Haitian families essentially just took their belongings and went to the most familiar or the closest open spaces. And in Port-au-Prince, the humanitarian system responded by setting up camp management agencies, which are referred to as CMAs, within these spontaneous settlements. And the CMAs generally within the humanitarian system and also in Haiti are charged with assessing the needs of residents, of prioritizing goods and services, and then ensuring adequate governance systems within those camps. Despite the wide range of involvement of all of the sort of most familiar INGOs, there was an insufficient number of agencies to cover the number of settlements, just given the size of the city and the number of camps. And there were over 1,000 camps in the city. And that already was a question around just collecting data to count the camps. NGOs work on a project model through which they endeavor to service a specific grouping of households or camps with a set of packaged goods and services, which are usually measured through project indicators, which are in turn often modeled on these industry standards, such as SPHERE. To ensure they can both ensure minimum quality standards and measure that impact, measure that they've done this, there's been a noted tendency of NGOs to prefer to work in locations and with populations where they can guarantee their ability to meet that minimum standard. This dynamic has been critiqued as humanitarian containment, since it limits the positive impact that humanitarians can have on an entire affected population. In my research, I uncovered this dynamic in Haiti, where well-serviced camps sit right alongside totally unmanaged camps. Because CMAs are judged according to their ability to meet indicators of minimum quality and accountability in relation to the project's beneficiaries, the incentives are to prioritize quality over coverage. Failures of quality and coverage within project sites are traceable to specific CMAs, but failures of coverage for the entire disaster or affected population are traceable to the amorphous humanitarian system where accountability is dispersed. The impact on residents of living in unmanaged camps is significant. Without agencies coordinating aid, goods and services are delivered irregularly, if at all. A survey carried out by human rights organizations in different IDP camps in February found sporadic, infrequent, and apparently arbitrary food distributions, contaminated water, and radically inadequate shelter. By June 2010, an estimated 66% of all IDP households in Port-au-Prince were in locations that had CMAs, while a striking 34% of households were in sites where no agency was ensuring delivery of coordinated services. The second dynamic is to look at this concept of participation. And in the paper, I talk about this a lot in relation to the HAP standard, which looks at procedural requirements around participation of beneficiaries in programming and their ability to access accountability structures like complaints mechanisms. Recognizing the disempowering effects of disaster relief efforts, humanitarians have constructed indicators also within SPHERE aimed at ensuring beneficiary participation in programming. So SPHERE has been called its common standards, where indicators concerning the process of providing relief can be found, and that includes these participation and consultation requirements. So SPHERE isn't meant to be only about chasing these targets for substantive minimum quality, but also about ensuring that those affected by the disaster have a say in how that disaster relief is delivered. One expert interviewed for the paper complained that in Haiti, the system that NGOs have set up for coordination, quote, is ingeniously set up to insulate the people making the decisions from the information they need to make the decisions they're making. So cluster meetings through which humanitarian organizations coordinate their work on a weekly basis, for example, are routinely held at the UN logistical base, which is very far from the center of town, often takes hours to get there in a car or a tap-tap. And you have to go past a carefully guarded security gate, which routinely turns away Haitians who might not have an identity card. Despite this, 83% of online survey respondents reported that using indicators ensures the active participation of beneficiaries, which suggests that process-related indicators are at least viewed as an effective tool. When humanitarian aid is delivered, though, via projects that are not well connected to larger existing Haitian systems, the impact of that commitment to participation, I would argue, can be severely limited. One of the main factors limiting its impact is the unit of analysis for participation, where NGOs essentially count, for example, the number of consultation meetings they had to design a water distribution system. So they're not counting their interaction with an existing Haitian system, but they're counting how many Haitians can they get to participate in their own programming. And so the concept of participation, then, and accountability are limited by the logic of project management. That really is a way of approaching participation as a technical exercise, and humanitarians thus allied the political issue of, for example, how can poor people participate in their country's rebuilding? Is it wise, you might ask, for Haitians to spend a great deal of unpaid, we might add, time consulting with NGOs about how to implement a project? Or would their time be better spent engaging in civic action, working to influence the country's future? Finally, I just want to talk briefly about this issue of protection. Protection is what humanitarians call, essentially what human rights people would call civil and political rights. There are real problems introduced through the audit culture of indicators, but those problems are not always the proliferation or call for data. Sometimes it's the lack of data. And in the part of the paper where I talk about the structure of SPHERE, I look at the fact that there aren't indicators for protection. And this is something that some of the experts I interviewed noted. They said, you know, it's fascinating that there are all of these indicators for the substantive areas of service provision, but when we come to protection, there are no indicators. And in fact, in the revision process, there's now a chapter on protection, but there are no indicators. And the experts I spoke to said that was because it was either too difficult to create them because it's an uncountable phenomenon, or it's simply, you know, others said this is because it's too political. It just simply makes things too difficult for humanitarians. Advocates working in Haiti have underscored this reluctance by looking and calling for humanitarians to create data around, in particular, rape and forcible eviction or forcible displacement. And essentially what has happened here is that the subcluster that deals with gender-based violence has really taken on the mantra that one rape is too much and sort of is attempting to steer around this problem of not having numbers by sort of saying over and over again, we don't need numbers because we know that one rape is too much. Women's rights organizations in Haiti have then gone about instead themselves counting rapes. And so they're coming forward with, you know, just numbers of hundreds and hundreds of women who are being raped in the IDP camps. And so what they're calling for now is the systematic integration of collection of data on rape in particular by humanitarian organizations. A similar dynamic occurs around a forced eviction, which I won't go into given the time. But specifically, the program management logic appears to also contribute to these protection gaps. So CMAs are responsible for monitoring protection within the camps under their management, which means that it's essentially this kind of roving protection cluster. So they're protection experts also. They are responsible for the humanitarian situation as a whole, but accountability, again, is measured through these projects. So that, again, means that people in unmanaged camps tend to be significantly more vulnerable to protection issues or civil and political rights violations issues. So that means that indicators projects, in particular when they fail to include indicators for things like rape or eviction, may shift attention away from those violations by failing to include relevant metrics for such abuses. And then again, sort of calling attention to the need to look at this phenomenon of these compliant camps or sphere compliant camps sitting next to completely sphere non-compliant camps. So in conclusion, rights-based standards and indicators are really central now to emergency action and disaster response. They integrate specific understandings of human rights. They're self-regulation projects that attempt to codify lessons learned by the humanitarian community following a series of humanitarian failures. They use the language of management and the logics of audit. And they attempt to encapsulate knowledge and expertise of professional humanitarians across key sectors. And in that, they really do represent an impressive collaborative effort by this transnational network to kind of learn lessons. There's a lot of language around lesson learning and around continual improvement that I have to say, as a human rights advocate, is way better than we've ever done. So I have to sort of tip my hat on that way. But they also tend to elide these core tensions that led to their creation. So they displace the kinds of dilemmas that led to those very crises, displace them onto these issues of metrics. And the current debates over what to measure and monitor via these indicators can be understood as symptoms of those unresolved tensions. Those unresolved tensions are very much visible in the humanitarian response in Haiti. I think attention to those elided dilemmas would actually allow humanitarians to continue to kind of use the power of numbers in these moments when that's really necessary, but also to understand and perhaps attempt to transcend the limits of those numbers.
So thanks very much, Meg. So we turn now to our colleague, Professor Ryan Goodman, to act as a discussant.
Okay, so thanks for the opportunity to comment on three terrific projects. I realize we're short on time, so that many of these questions I'll try to reframe as comments or suggestions, and we can take them up in later conversation. And as Professor Kingsbury had alluded to, some of my students in the room, and I'd asked them to prepare a question of their own that I might incorporate, and if I did incorporate it, I'd provide them attribution. They're able to scold me or reprimand me in other ways if I don't give the attribution. But they should also feel free to ask questions if there's an opportunity in Q&A, or do so afterwards to the speakers, or send them their questions by email, because they really are terrific set of questions. So let me first just deal with the first paper, Nehal's paper, and ask a few critical questions. The first one is about the social effects of what you've termed information infrastructures. And here I'm referring a little bit more to the paper than to your opening remarks. One is, I'm not sure whether or not these are being used in a causal manner that's inappropriate. So at the very end, in terms of what's the cash value of your argument, you say measures purporting to rank degrees of weakness to the extent they imply some idea of the likelihood of failure are misleading. Causal relations cannot be specified, and specified in the most part are not established. But I'm wondering, even if they're not causal, even if they're just correlative, what's wrong with them as an indicator of these are emergency situations or states that are edging towards failure or already at complete failure? So there's not a causal explanation. Some of them are, even as you say earlier in the paper, symptoms, not causes. And that would be enough for the institutional purpose that they've been set for either development purposes or security. The other cash value you say at the end of the paper is that the concept is poor because it's, quote, defined largely by its extremes, Sweden or Somalia, but it's hard to differentiate Bangladesh and Djibouti. But the question then once again would be, are these projects about trying to identify the spectrum, or are they really projects about trying to identify failed states? So that one would at least want to differentiate the thrust of your criticism in their use, because they might be highly useful if we're trying to target the worst of the worst in terms of conditions for allocating development assistance that's a scarce scarce resource or thinking about security threats that only really emerge when they've reached the bottom of the bottom or the extreme. Lastly, is the normative claim that you make that the indicators skew development priorities. But the question might still be, even if they skew development priorities and we grant that concern, maybe they still increase the size of the pie. So yes, they maybe shift resources from A to B, but because we have the concept of the failed state or state effectiveness, it increases concern around these matters, and the pie, the resources that are dedicated to these issues, means that B gets more than it would have gotten absent this information infrastructure. So that's one question about the social effects. The second question is a baseline question. You refer to the what's rendered invisible by this new form of knowledge, but I wonder what it would otherwise replace. So I'm concerned potentially by the fact that the knowledge that exists prior to this information infrastructure is worse, less reliable, filled with more biases than we'd otherwise know, and filled with invisible assumptions and political ideological commitments. So what's really interesting in some respects about the chart is that it actually does break up what people might mean when they say state effectiveness, and then we can have a debate and discourse about it. The very conference itself, your very paper itself, it renders those kinds of things possible. The second is, and that's much better than in the 1990s, as you say, or the 1980s as well, that the notion of a failed state emerged, but nobody was really being very specific about what they meant. What is the content of subclassifications of the failed or state or state effectiveness? As well as it might also challenge our assumptions and enlighten or reveal things and make them more visible. For example, I thought it was really interesting that on the chart, we had all these 25 failed states purportedly, but there were many little blue and green squares. And then it challenges us to think you can still be a failed state even if you have political stability, even if you've acquired social cohesion or legitimacy. And then the reverse is true as well. It doesn't reify the state. We might find, if we look at the top 25 states, that some of them are actually very weak on territorial control, for example. And then it would defeat our notion of an ideal type or a reified state that must have control over its own territories because it could be weak in that subsection. Last point is just about some other avenues that you might pursue, because as you've identified, the project is still young in its formation. And those are avenues about the social organization of knowledge. So the soft suggestion would be, it'd be interesting to try to explain something that to the reader, and I think to you yourself and as an author, is probably a puzzle. What explains the persistent consumption of these flawed methods and measures? Isn't that a market failure, especially if some of the consumers are private industries and corporations that are paying a lot, top dollar for some of the results? Yet they haven't engaged in Bayesian updating to recognize that the research, that these methods are so flawed as you identify them to be, or suggest that they are. So what explains it? A second is, why is there a felt need to redesign the measure? So it's so interesting when you give us all the different institutions that are engaged in this measurement, why they need to reinvent the wheel or think of themselves as distinctive. So those are interesting avenues that you might pursue. I mean, a little bit more of a critical edge would be that your answer to those questions would have to therefore be consistent with your theoretical model, which might be a tough one. Last point is, I thought it was interesting just to learn something from the other two papers. I thought there was an interesting discussion in your paper that the measures are, in fact, influenced by what is measurable out there in the world. And then the other papers, both of them, talk a lot about strategic behavior, or as Rene put it, the gaming of the indicator. And the next step would be, if we understand that the indicator itself can be gamed, then I would imagine those who produce the indicators try to find ways around gaming of the indicator, so that they instead reconstruct or choose different indicators. So it might also be interesting not just to determine what they think is measurable, and then that defines the field of knowledge, but also what they feel is less gameable. That might be one as well that the other papers seem to be pointing to. On Renee's paper, I just wanted to first start out by thinking about the premise of the paper where you map the idea that there are these two parties involved and you want to focus more on the governed than the governors. And I just want to try to problematize even those concepts of the governed and the governors, because I think that the categories start to merge into each other or ways in which they overlap with each other. First, I would have thought of the governed as the executive or the government itself, but at some points in the discussion, it seems as though you're may be veering into saying that the media is a representation of or part of instantiation of the governed. But it seems that at least in the framing paper for the conference, the media is separate and is inside of the public sphere. The other, in terms of who is the governed, is it that the government themselves, the national sovereign institutions, well, it doesn't seem to be because your paper is very useful in disaggregating the state and thinking of the Constitutional Court as very different from the other branches of government and the way in which they work against each other. So I'm not sure who's the governed anymore in that picture, because I think you explode the category in a useful way. Also, what is a local organization? I don't know anything about the organizations that you've identified, but if they're being funded by international organizations, INGOs, or states, I'm not sure how local the production of their knowledge is anymore. And that would also maybe not be particularly relevant to Colombia, I don't know, but it certainly would be particularly relevant to the generalizability of your theoretical claim in that respect. And lastly, who is the governed and the governed in this instance, when the states themselves are responsible for generating the indicators, at least insofar as the IGOs are being utilized, are utilizing the indicators, then it seems as though the states are, just as we know in international law, the regulators or self-enforcers of their own destiny. Why isn't that the same case here, which problematizes the two-party binary that you articulate at the beginning and seem to buy into, but the paper is very good about problematizing other ways. Second is, I think it might be useful to define more by what you mean by appropriation. So when I saw appropriation at the beginning, I thought it was tantalizing. I thought you were going to maybe demonstrate ways in which the local actors would use the measures and the indicators against the governors, or contrary to the interests of the governors, or against their interests, at the very least. And instead, what we find in the paper, I think, is that the indicators are just amplified. So this is just a transmission belt in which this is the ways in which the indicators are utilized and spread by the local actors. I could cite some of the students by name, but multiple students actually came up with the same idea, that it just seems as though it would be somewhat logical or obvious that the, in fact, interest of the governors is the very phenomena of local actors utilizing the indicators, that they aren't necessarily the first producers of, admittedly, the interesting cycle that you have that starts with the local actors might be the beginning place for it, but that's how we would think that it would maybe translate and be diffused in the local space. It doesn't seem to be that it's shifting the agenda differently. It seems to be an agenda that's supported by the governors themselves, doesn't seem to be contrary to them, if anything, amplifies them. Last point here is just a methodological one about the generalizability of a case study, as well as evaluating the proof or evidence presented by the case study. So one of the students, Thomas Ernest, asked the question, what results would take place in countries in which there's a closed or government-regulated media? So you make strong claims about the media, but it's counterfactual. What if the media weren't there? Could we maybe still see, demonstrate a significant number of the effects? How many of the effects? And how would we test this otherwise? So it might be good to just acknowledge that that's a further area for research. Similarly, at first when I read the paper, I thought this is another interesting project that demonstrates the ways in which particular branches of government are empowered by global governance. So Kim Shepley's work on the way in which the executive is empowered by global governance structures. And here we find courts are empowered by global government structures. But then Emily McKenzie, another one of the students, asks the question, if this is true that the court feels that it's empowered by the use of statistics, is this a general trend that we see among courts? Now, I think her question might have been more about courts within Colombia, but I would even say courts in other countries. If this is true, then we would, I think, anticipate there's a predictive nature to your claim that courts would be doing this time and again, and I don't know that they are. Last is a question of methodology as well, and that's the definition of effectiveness. So on page 28, you say, this proves that CODES was effective. Why? Because the Constitutional Court brought them into a power structure in which they therefore were at the leadership of producing the indicators. But at some level, I think that that's not necessarily a definition of effectiveness. I don't know whether or not the indicators have produced any different social outcome. All that happened to the organization is that they got more immersed in the production of indicators. One could actually think of that as de-radicalizing the organization. I'm not sure how much further it goes from that. Similarly, even in your remarks, you say the Constitutional Court issues this landmark opinion in which it doesn't have certain powers, so instead it produces the obligation to produce indicators. I think of that as maybe an indication, a sign of abject weakness on the part of a court, that the best they can do is ask for more numbers. To be as critical or as skeptical about it as possible. Last one on that is a one-way ratchet. You do talk about the indicator serving as a form of social mobilization or creates a sense of urgency. It's on page 26, naming and shaming. But why wouldn't we also need to consider the countervailing effects? It seems to be that the ratchet would go the other direction. If the numbers start improving, if next year it's 400,000 or 380,000, so that there's a trend line in the direction of less IDPs within the country, fewer IDPs within the country, then doesn't that give the government more breathing space? Or you quote the ombudsman making a statement that there are 24 million displaced people around the world and Colombia only counts for 548,000. That use of indicators actually could have a de-radicalizing, a demobilizing effect. on social actions. I'm not sure why the paper seems to just focus on the one valence and not the other, the other ways in which the errors might point. The last paper is Meg's paper. I thought it was a truly great paper. It not only provided information that I was unaware of, but also I think just changes our way of thinking about issues in a profound way. So I just have three quick points. The first is that the paper seemed to be framed as showing deep concerns about the use of indicators in these contexts and the unintended consequences of them. But I wondered to what degree the paper is also just suggesting that the solution to the problem is more and better indicators. So the one place it's most obvious is in protection, especially when you don't talk about the Haiti example in particular, but you talk more generally about Sphere and HAP, and it seems to be there's a gap there. It's a weakness that we don't have indicators for protection. Another instance is coverage. You yourself rely on indicators. You say 34% of households aren't within the CMAs. That's an indicator. So I would say, let's get more indicators to demonstrate what the coverage is like. The problem in terms of the system effects, or what otherwise are called, I guess, the early recovery periods in which we aren't getting sustainability within Haiti because we're displacing Haitian or local institutions. Here's the solution, indicators. We can find indicators that would determine that. We might have HAP have them in terms of procedural indicators that actors that have the interest of the long-term sustainability are involved in the process, or it could be Sphere substantive criteria. But it's just the question that I think your paper seems to tend towards that as a potential avenue, and it might be one in which you actually embrace it as well. Second question or concern is the use of Foucault's model. And I think that this might be a mismatch. So just to be fair, in my own work, I've utilized Foucault and I've thought about the same criticisms. I'm not sure I've overcome them myself because I think it's a difficulty of using Foucault in international law and also in governance issues like this. Also, there are contested definitions and interpretations of Foucault. So the question, the reason that it might be a mismatch is first, some of the argument you're making suggests that the action and these institutions are behaving more like states. Page 25 refers to somebody else saying that they have state effects. But from a Foucauldian analysis, I would think that we're looking much more at micro level interactions, not centralized, and it's ideational. It's not about strings being attached, which these ones seem to be that kind of form of acting like the traditional state or having state powers. Second, actors play a major role in the project. The actors are self-aware. Your interviewees, many of them are self-aware. The donors at one point you say, and I was trying to see if you would say it, and then you said the donors are aware of some of these concerns. Also, there's strategic choices being made by the actors, especially the example of how many liters per family. They understand what's being produced by that indicator versus a Foucauldian analysis that might be much more about discourse, it's much more about social structure, not about, and social construction of knowledge, not about those actors or their own realization of the action in which they're engaged. So when Foucault's talking about the bizarre practices of the medical community hundreds of years ago, they really thought that those bizarre practices worked. It wasn't that they were using them as leverage or leverage to gain in some instrumentalist reason. And the last point here is just the point about how do we evaluate this at the end. I think the project is successful no matter what on identifying the unintended consequences. So I don't think it has to carry the burden of demonstrating how did we cast this out or even thinking about what the framework would be to answer that question. Because you might just say, here's the framework for answering how it cashes out overall. But the two concerns I have about how it cashes out are first, the baseline question again. What is it displacing? So at times in the paper, I thought that the assumption is that it's displacing better coverage, for example, and I don't know why it's not displacing a return to the bad old days of Rwanda or overlapping jurisdictions so that the humanitarian actors don't know who's doing what on the ground. So that's the baseline question. And then the last question is, once again, doesn't it maybe increase the size of the pie? So it might be true that some groups are not getting as many resources, but the use of the indicators does drive sympathy, empathy, and even the willingness of certain donors to give money because they think it can be measured.
Well, thanks very much to Ryan Goodman for those characteristically superb comments and to the formidable team of student intellect, which has helped inspire that, and also to the students for taking the trouble to read the papers so thoughtfully and stimulate that. So this conference is run, you know, by our standards, quite beautifully to schedule up until this session, where, and actually at the end of it, we're a little over time. I think we can definitely dispense with what would have been the very short wrap-up bit at the end. Maybe I'll just say a few sentences, a small number of sentences at the very end of the, on behalf of the organisers about the future, etc. not very interesting about the future, but some elements of the future. But we'll just spend a few minutes to have some chance for people to raise questions and comments, and we will stifle all responses of any description other than body language, which can be freely distributed. So anyone who wants to make a statement, or a question, comment, if you could make it fairly brief, but please launch in. No. So I think we'll try to finish at about 5 till 6. So we have 10 minutes. We'll still be reasonably on schedule. I think the students can still get to what they've got to do if we stop at 5 to 6. So, okay, Greg Schiffer is the first bold soul.
I mean, I think it maybe raises a larger question, but I pose it to the three panelists, which is in part in line with Ryan's questioning, is do we see a division within the project between lawyers who want to look at it, sort of how indicators can bring us to, can be improved or bring us to a better place, a better world, and that those from other disciplines who are looking at the relationship between law and indicators, who are suggesting that perhaps indicators shape law, that there's not much role for law, that law sort of is one is it's either produced by indicators or it plays into indicators. It leads into also it. There's different actors who are using it for different purposes, which is a more of a descriptive approach to where the relationship between law and indicators, as opposed to a normative one. And I was just wondering how the three of you played out, which I see as a tension in within the conference itself.
I think it is, but I think let's see if more people would like to make any kind of comment. It could be very specific. If it's something specific to something going on in Haiti or a state effectiveness question or something in Colombia, it's also feel free to speak up in those ways, as well as more big picture ones. So, yes, Matthias Goldman.
Just a very short comment on Nidal's paper. Should we really be so critical about indicators concerning failed states? Because let's think of what we had before. We have a very crude classification in law, which only has a binary distinction between state and non-state. And I think such a differentiated picture has a lot of value, even though, of course, it opens an avenue for imperialistic tendencies.
So some more comments people would like to make. I would warmly encourage the students to speak up. In fact, I'm very tempted to call on them, but I'm sure I don't have a license to do that, so. I also can't see that far. That's another complication. Wave your hand vigorously, whoever it is. Oh yeah, please. Thanks.
Yeah, Nehal, I also had a question regarding, I think, the market for these indicators. And I'd like to hear your thoughts a little bit more on sort of the concrete interests and sort of factions buying these and encouraging the production of different scales. And because I think the commentator is onto something, and I wonder what you view sort of the post 9/11 climate and the creation of knowledge industries around the problem of state failure being defined as the global security threat that we're facing now, right? Failed states incubate groups and organizations like Al-Qaeda. So this indices of state failure that various U.S. government agencies are trying to produce simultaneously are also linked into that kind of security concern. I wonder if you think that's relevant at all in looking at some of the origins of these.
So this was Alex Cooley from Columbia. Now one of the students, Nikki Reich.
Thanks. Thank you for presenting all the papers. I thought they were really, really interesting. Just a couple of really quick remarks unrelated to one another, really. One was just in response to a comment that Mr. Uruena made. I think he said at one point that indicators are important to those without political power, referring to the technocratic branch or the bureaucracies. And I guess I would just point out that I think they're extremely important to those with political power, precisely for the opposite reason, to mask the wielding of that political power and to give it a technocratic veil. I think institutions like those referenced by other speakers, such as the MDBs or the United States and USAID, do it all the time. So that was just a small point. But I guess the other one is a question for Mr. Bhuta as well with regard to the audience. I was also intrigued by the sort of paying consumers of this data, these data. And I was curious to know there was this sort of implication, although I understand the work is unfinished as of yet, that the lack of transparency, I was reading in a critique of the lack of transparency and the errors inherent in the aggregation upon aggregation, and I certainly would agree with a lot of that, but I wondered if you thought then, is there an imperative or a normative reason why formulators or producers of those indices need to be accountable for how they're created, and to whom should they then be accountable? Are they? Is it a moral obligation of accountability to the states who are being measured, or is it to the development aiders, those who are giving aid or allocating it in accordance with them, or perhaps defining their national security policies on that basis? And then a final question was just with regard to whether or not Professor Satterthwaite thought about the role of media in covering the crisis in Haiti, and whether, just building on Mr. Uruena's piece, whether media helped in fact to resolve some of the gaps and in fact to force some of those inadequacies of the indicators that are being used, whether that's protection or outside the camps, to the fore, and what that might mean for the future. Thanks.
Did anyone else like to make a comment or ask a question? So in that case, I'm going to give you 1 minute each to say something thoughtful, incisive, and relevant. Meg, you could be a leader in that role.
That's so terribly mean. Okay, I actually have a really hard time summarizing my thoughts. I think the issue of kind of is the answer more indicators or not is the key thing that I'm really struggling with, and I think it's evident in my paper. I do think that the issue of kind of, I mean, there's always going to be a choice of indicator, right? Because one of the big problems for humanitarians always is time. And so there's never going to be enough time to do what they need to do. And that's part of why they're driven to create these accountability structures, et cetera. So I do think that the only answer that would be legible to them is better indicators versus more indicators. So, but I understand that I need to reconcile that with my critique, and I don't actually have an incisive answer to that at all, except that I think that's a really important point. In terms of the kind of role of the media, and I do think this also comes back to the increasing the size of the pie, I think the media has played a really crucial role, but it's always that question of capture of, you know, capture of attention, you know, crisis fatigue, et cetera. And so this problem in Haiti right now is a problem that will be going on for many years. And so I do think the media has played that role of sort of closing some of the gaps, in particular around gender-based violence, because women's organizing has been so effective, and they have come up with numbers that the media did repeat. In fact, our major organizing partner from Kof Aviv got into the New York Times, and that just changed the whole thing. I mean, she suddenly had the doors open at the UN to her. But I do also think that we can't count on that. So it has to be kind of integrated into the system, and potentially that means better, newer and better indicators, but potentially not.
All right, so very briefly, I agree with you up to a point, but I think, concerning the importance of indicator for those who are without power, but I guess the need to justify your own power to others through indicators means that you really don't have that much power in a way, so that you need justification. And so it may be a process of who yields the ultimate power in a way. But certainly, at least in the impression that I got from congressmen in Colombia, when they felt that they actually didn't have to justify their own power, was the moment when they said, I don't care about indicators. So that's the first point. The second point, what the gentleman referred to of national security and indicators in Colombia, that's quite an issue. So intelligence agencies are starting to gather indicators. So it's quite a project now. So clearly it is of interest to academics, but to other kind of people as well, because clearly, at least in the IDP situation, indicators on internally displaced population is a very important source of intelligence regarding the domestic conflict. So, and that is starting to happen. And that's actually one of the reasons why, for instance, CODIS is starting to have serious problems. So that's, and the last thing regarding Professor Schaffer's question, I have the same limit. I mean, I'm wondering the same thing. So what's the added value of law and international law in this context. So we have gathered information, we have a theory of law which explains up to a point that, you know, it's not Austinian positivism, it's a way, you know, it's law as regulation, so it may be a supplement, it may be a complement to law, but what's specifically, what are we contributing as lawyers in this context that, you know, that economists are not doing or sociologists are not doing in a way? So I'm trying to, you know, to figure out the same thing. I don't know.
Okay, so I'll start my minute. Let me see if I can answer the questions briefly, starting with Greg Schaffer. Do I think that we can build better indicators to make the place, to make the world a better place? I'm really not sure. I don't think there's a yes or no answer to that question. Do lawyers have much of a role? Actually, probably not, in my view. Responding to Alex Cooley, so the short answer is yes. September 11 is pretty important in this discussion. The question is exactly how, and that's a harder question. I am very reluctant to reduce this to abstract, idealizing concepts such as a market in information. There is no single market for the information, for this kind of information. There's a variety of demands, there's a variety of needs, and there's a whole bunch of peculiar and accidental incidents that can be traced as to the way in which these particular forms of information are produced. And that's precisely what has to be determined. I have an allergy, to say the least, to overly reductive accounts because it misses what the real contingency. Ian Hacking, who I think is by far the best historian of statistical thinking today, points out that the emergence of statistical methods and particular modes of statistical reasoning are a combination of little incidents and global needs. And that's, I think, the way we have to start thinking about the emergence of this information. Just as an aside, to emphasize the security dimensions, there is another set of indicators that's being produced which are classified. I know they exist, but I haven't seen them, and they actually use the same database as the USAID. Professor Goodman posed a number of questions. If I can just try and answer very shortly, does it matter that they can't identify the middle? Yes, because that's what they're purporting to be able to do. They're not purporting to be able to identify the limit cases. They're being purported to identify those that are approximating failure, somewhere closer to failure, and they're less likely to fail. So it's very important to be able to differentiate the grades. And so the question is if whether the data actually allows them to do that is an important question for their self-described purpose. Does it increase the size of the pie? I don't know. I think that's an empirical question and remains to be seen. Does it matter that they are not causal? Is it possible that these things are just correlates? Well, I think they are just correlates. The question is, though, that the this is a longer argument, but the claim I would be making is that the way in which the production of the indicator is bundling the concept is actually integrating a set of causal claims about the nature of state failure, thus allowing us to determine where a state is on the path to failure. That's actually quite a causal claim, and that seems to be a predicate of the demand to measure it, as opposed to if all we wanted to know is whether these countries exhibit these symptoms, we don't need an indicator of state failure, we just need a list of the underlying indicators that are used to produce the aggregate.
So, I'd like to thank the three speakers here. It's really three unique papers, and I think each of them is a real substantial contribution, of course, in the different stages of development, but I think we'll see the value here of taking topics which there's a lot written, state failure, internally displaced people and disasters, but looking at through one angle, in this case the indicators, the data, the management questions, and seeing a whole new line of problems and something really important there. So I think it's emblematic of what could be done in scholarly terms by looking at seriously at these things. And congratulations to those speakers, and thanks again to Ryan. So we come to the end of this conference. We've hugely appreciated all the people who've been willing to come. There's been a really tremendous amount of talent and insight, a lot of important specific work, a lot of really excellent theoretical thinking brought together here. The people who wrote the papers and presented the discussants and the general gathering, I think it's really been stimulating. We've been very, very cheered, I think, by that, as well as enlightened. I think we see here, and I'm speaking casually now for Angelina, Sally, and Kevin, but they can leap to their feet, and is that there is something here, we think intellectually, which does look like there's a valuable research agenda, and there's something about the perspectives which is probably going to open sort of windows into issues which aren't being addressed properly, and where this elements of interdisciplinary juxtaposition, combination learning is producing a set of research questions and some approaches which we think really could be a fruitful agenda going forward. So I think we think there's probably, we think there is going to be value in producing some sort of edited book from this to try to help to frame this. Of course, there's already important literature, but we think we can move it along, and also developing a wider research agenda, and perhaps with some mapping of possible topics, a little bit of dividing up the waterfront and thinking of which voices are in and how it could work, which could be through panels at big conferences like Law and Society, et cetera, but also maybe more specific conferences and targeted programs. And we'd invite people who have ideas about that. Of course, we can only do little bits of it, but also tell us you're thinking of this or what about this idea, et cetera. And we can talk together about how that, things like that might work. So we see some quite fruitful structures. We have some experience of this with the Global Minister of Law Project, which has had conferences all around the world, and probably 6 or 8 symposia of books and things have come out. Probably it's 150 papers or something from that research agenda, as well as other teams quite separately doing important stuff. So indicators may not be on that scale, but we do see some sort of future for that. I think an edited book from this, it shouldn't be a book of the conference, but a book about the topic. So we'd have to think what seems to cohere, different of the papers would fit together in different ways, but we'll try to organize what we think might be a systematic plan and send out a note about that. So I think that's what to say on the immediate thing. Anything to add or subtract, Sally?
Just would like to thank everybody for coming and contributing all their ideas, and we hope that you will be interested in contributing a paper, thinking about doing this as we put this together, because we think there really should be some kind of document to come out of this to reflect our thinking. So keep tuned for more thinking about that from our direction. Thanks again.
And just to echo those comments, I'd like to thank you all for coming. And even though I've been thinking about this with Benedict and Sally, and even before that, I guess, for several years now, I feel like I've learned a tremendous amount over the past couple of days, and it's been a very rewarding experience. So thanks again to all of you.
So then I'd like to return again now the thanks to Angelina, who's been both one of the four organizers of it. And the organizer who's done the vast amount of the actual work. And giving a paper at your own conference is always a mistake, but it's particularly a mistake when you're relatively young and all that, and when you've got 50 million other things to do, you'll be dumping on you. So, Angela, we really appreciate the success with which you've achieved all of those things. And she's been very much helped by Alma Fuentes and the IOJ, who's organized all kinds of things, not so visible, but very important. And Megan Donaldson and Curie Mattis and several other of our fellows have lent a warm hand to this. And we've also had much help from the law school, and as I mentioned at the beginning, from Carnegie Corporation of New York, who've really funded this and us very generously, as well as the Rockefeller Foundation and the NSF. So for those involved in the NSF part, we have to very soon head off to the workshop where that thing starts this evening. So we admire your stamina and our own, and then that'll be going on tomorrow. So for those going to that NSF group now, we should get together and head over there. So, and many thanks to everybody for coming.
So I'll email you.